Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, and to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I say Shabbat Shalom. I hope you have a blessed and peaceful Sabbath day. Now, today's lesson is titled, My Blank Won't Go to Church With Me. And the reason why I quoted church is because the word church is used to denote or convey the sentiment that is often used. And more often than not, what the person is really saying is, my husband or my wife won't worship with me or go to worship with me or take this spiritual walk with me. Now, typically the one who won't go to church or to worship with the other is the husband. And I, myself, like plenty of others, have grown up in households where the mother's the one who gets all the children together on worship day and get them all dressed and everything and usher us all off to church while dad does what dad does, which is maybe just stay at home. But moms are typically the ones always in church and dragging the kids with them. And this hasn't changed much because the enemy understands and knows that the man or the husband is supposed to be the head of the household. So he has plenty stumbling blocks and traps in a way for men to distract them and keep them from attending worship and strengthening their faith and being that spiritual leader in the household like he's supposed to. In particular, these things perfectly set in place. He has the NFL, he has the NBA, he has the MLB, and let's not forget the NHL. This is what he has to distract a lot of fathers on worship day, which for most of you I know is on Sunday. A lot of these fathers are sitting back on Sunday, resting up, getting ready for their game in the early Sunday afternoon. So this in particular is one reason why many don't attend worship service. All these leagues, these professional sports, are keeping these men from growing their faith. It's keeping them from being the spiritual, respected, and honorable leaders of their family. It creates a lot of chaos and stress and adversity in households when mothers are the ones getting everyone together and ushering them off to church and being the spiritual leader. But sometimes this becomes the case where the mothers, the women, are the spiritual leaders of their household. And the enemy loves it that way because he has everything flipped upside down as opposed to the way it should be. Now granted, I've been known to enjoy a sport or two, but by no means am I going to give up my time with the Father for a game, because the Word does so much more for me. And besides, I get to share it with you all. So I'm not going to be distracted by sports when I can be doing this, something that I truly love and enjoy that much more. Go with me to 2 Corinthians 6:14, which reads like this. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? That was verse 15. Now these scriptures for me are the prime basis of a relationship, be it spiritually or worldly. But first, answer this question. When you first got together with your mate, was it under any of the following conditions or situations? And was it partly the basis of the relationship existing until you started this spiritual walk that you're on? So pay attention and decide for yourself, because you know better than I do what got you all together and where you are now. Now, also I would ask you, did you really get to know this person that you're with, that you're married to now? Did you get to know their habits, their character, their temperament, their likes, their dislikes? Or did you just fall in love or in lust and just run with it? Because plenty of people are married today and they ran with those lustful feelings and emotions and everything. And then they started figuring and finding things out along the way, which has ended them up in the situations that they're in now. And a lot of you want to find yourself in a spiritual sense, but the other person not so much. So we have to understand that relationships are a serious issue, and we have to take them as such if we want them to last. But we have to get into them correctly. Today, you have zero chance if you don't get together in the beginning with a believer, someone walking the walk and talking the talk. If you get together with someone based on attraction and lustful feelings, you're doomed before you even get started, because the world today will set you at variance with one another before you can blink an eye. There's too much going on, there's too much chaos, and it's only progressively getting worse. Remember, you have to be right, and you have to make sure you seek and only accept the right person. And I mean by doing right by the Father. Remember, Ephesians 6:12 tells us what? For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of the world, of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. We have to always keep that in mind. This is not a flesh battle. This is all about the spiritual battle. And if we don't go into these relationships spiritually armed, we are not going to succeed. Now, if you're getting involved, or if you're involved in a worldly relationship and you don't believe that you are a worldly person, my warning to you is turn away from it now before you even get started. Because if you think you're going to be doing right and get involved with someone living in the world and that relationship's going to work, you're setting yourself up for disaster. And that's not what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to find someone equally yoked within the Father, and this is who we are to come together with. These relationships can stand the test of time because you're already halfway there. Now, if your relationship started out in all this worldliness and all this partying and all these different things that I just mentioned, but now you've come away from all that and you're embracing that walk with the Father and doing right by His word, and what you're saying to me is, I'm complaining or have this complaint because my mate is still in the world, kind of, sort of, completely, or not so much, but they're not taking that walk with you. When we speak of the before mentioned scriptures, Corinthians 6:14 and 15, you can look at it also that it's saying that people who are unbelievers, they can get together and have successful worldly relationships. Now, that doesn't mean that they aren't going to have all sorts of problems, because they are living in the world and they are not living by the Father. So when you're living out there in the world, you don't have the protection and the guidance of the Heavenly Father. You have the leadership and guidance of the world. But people doing the same thing out there in the world, they can be happy together. Two drunks can live happily ever after. Two drug addicts can live happily ever after. Two people love to party and drink can live happily ever after. But we know they're going to have major problems along the way because of what they're doing is of the world. Now, many couples today don't even start off with a spiritual foundation at all. But some kind of sort of do. You know, you may meet somebody at church or in a spiritual type setting of some sort. Or you meet someone, they go to church, you go to church, whatever the case is, whatever it is that you do. Some people believe that they're coming together with a spiritual foundation, so to speak, but it's not where it should be. So you have a lot of these couples that come together, and then along the way in these marriages there are all sorts of problems, because someone will kind of fall off one way or the other because it wasn't a solid and entrenched and very faithful spiritual foundation. It was an occasional thing, or it was kind of, you know, mediocre at best. This tends to be okay, like I said, until one or the other finds their way and want to go full throttle, and that's fine. But this creates another problem, because now you're the one full steam ahead and your husband or your wife, typically the husbands, like I said, aren't following suit. Now, this is a problem because
you can't make them.
So this can stress you and it can stress them, because you're showing your frustration with them not coming the way you're going, and vice versa. So it works both ways. Okay, rule number one. This is a must without fail. You must be the example spiritually. Be the example spiritually. Be the example spiritually. No ifs, ands, or buts. You must walk the walk, you must talk the talk, and you must do it without fail. Because every time you slip, trip, stumble, or fall, the enemy will call you out, he'll point it out, and it will only justify your mate's position to being resistant to doing what you're doing. And then on top of that, they're going to look at you as if you're just that same old wolf in sheep's clothing. See, you haven't changed. You're still the same old person putting on a front. That's how they're going to view it. So you must always be on guard if you're going to walk this walk and want your mate to join in. Psalms 119, 1-3 read like this. Blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. They also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. So, if you're going to walk the walk and talk the talk and be that spiritual example, you have to do it without fail. You have to be very careful. You have to always be on guard. That's what you must do. And also listen very carefully to 1 Peter 3:1 and understand what it's saying. I'm going to go through it. But it reads like this. 1 Peter 3:1 reads, likewise, let the wives be subject to their husbands, that even they which obey not the word may without the word be won by conversation of the wives. Now, 1 Peter 3:1 is deep because it tells the wives to be subject to their believing husbands in the first part. And we know that this man is the man that's good and obedient to the Father. The same man is to love his wife as our Savior loves us. And that comes from Ephesians 5:25. Now, what 1 Peter 3:1 also says is for the wife to be in subjection to her husband, even they which obey not the word. But we must understand that this verse is telling you to be subject to him in the Father. It doesn't say to violate the law if your husband does or try and lead you to do so. You're not to do that. You're always to obey the Father's law. This passage explains that in subjection to your husband, your honest and pure conversation may win him over to the Father. See, you have to lead spiritually because he's not doing it. So by your example, you have to be the one to plant seed in him or in her if it's a wife. You have to be that one. Now, keep in mind with anything else, you cannot badger or pressure your spouse into change. And that's with anything, but especially when you're talking about a spiritual change. Your walk of faith is a personal journey, and you may have to go it alone. But remember who's always there with you. John 13:33 reads, little children, yet a little while I am with you. Ye shall seek me. See, the Savior said that to the disciples at the time for them to know and understand that regardless, he is always with us. And we must remember that even when we're walking alone, he is with us. Remember, we cannot make someone believe what we believe. We are seesaws of the Father's word, and sometimes even in our own households. Now, keep in mind, it's just as important not to try to play the guilt game. Don't use the "you're supposed to be the head of the household" tactic or anything else to try and impose guilt on your mate, especially if it's the husband, to try and get him to do or lead spiritually as you want him to do. This can only cause you problems, so stay away from that kind of tactic. Stay loving and humble and faithful to the Father's word and do it his way. Plant the seed and wait patiently for it to grow. Now, like I said, you may have to become the head of the household spiritually by your leadership, especially if your husband is in a lost condition. We must let others develop on their own if it's within them to do so. We have to plant seed and move on. We have to plant seed and move on. And do what, you may ask? Well, here is some of what you do. You show continuing love to your spouse. And you pray to the Father that He creates a change in their heart. But remember, he will not make anyone do anything that they don't want to do. It's called free will. And he never denies any of us the power to make our own choices. So it has to be in him to do it. But if you're doing what you're supposed to do and planting that seed and leading spiritually and doing all those things, especially praying, the Father may prick that individual's heart and the light bulb may come on sooner or later. But we have to keep doing what we're doing. Remember, your spiritual walk can be all about you, especially if no one's walking it with you. Now, I mentioned prayer because it is probably the most powerful and the best gift we have in our arsenal. Prayer brings us into a state of calmness about situations and concerns going on in our life, and it also strengthens our faith while at the same time building our individual relationship with the Father. But at the same time, your prayers can be the prelude to helping someone else, like that person in that lost condition. So you must constantly and always pray. Stay in prayer. Do whatever it is you have to do, but pray whenever you get the opportunity. Prayer is very important. Keep in mind, the Father has a plan that may be 110% different from the plan we have. What we need to do in terms of planting seed and even helping in other ways, we can occasionally ask our spouse or our mate to join in worship with us, reading, or whatever the case may be. But we always have to do it with a humble and loving heart and with a contrite spirit. Regardless of the response, remember, you planted a seed. You were given an opportunity to plant a seed and you were allowed to do so. So if they reject these invitations, just be loving and humble and say, well, okay, I'll just go ahead and do whatever it is I'm doing. Also in this, your patience is going to be tested in every situation. Their patience is being tested in whatever it is they're doing, and yours is being tested in your spiritual leadership, in your spiritual walk, in your spiritual growth. We are being tested as well as the person who we view has an issue. We have issues too, and they're being tested. So we're going to have to go through whatever it is we go through, and they're going to have to go through whatever it is they go through. James 1 verses 2 through 4 read like this. My brother, count it all joy when ye fall into diverse temptations. And simply that means just be joyful whenever you go through diverse things, diverse temptations, diverse changes. Count it all joy, because if we're doing what's right, the Father is there with us. Verse 3 reads, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. See, we just talked about that. This is why we have to count it all joy. Our patience is being worked. It's being tested. Verse 4 reads, but let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing, so that we may become perfect in him. See, if we're perfect in the Father, we want for nothing. I'm not talking that worldly stuff. See, we can sit back all day and want and not receive worldly. We have to think at a spiritual level, at a totally different level. Now, number 4. If you and your husband and or wife didn't come together equally yoked as you should have in the Word, doing what's right and all these things, over time, some things are going to change. Just like when you live in totally worldly, things are going to change. Just as you've changed to find this spiritual walk and this growth path that you're on, you also have to allow for them to do the same. It may take longer, and obviously if you're there and they're not, they're moving at a different rate than you are. So don't get trapped by that distraction that the enemy keeps putting in your view. Remember, you married this individual. You're there with them all the time. So it's not going to go away by virtue of you wanting it to. You have to do your part with love and prayer and promoting the growth of those seeds that you plant around your spouse, because at the same time, this grows you. Remember, if it were easy, everybody would do it. People love doing things that are easy. So with that, keep in mind, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.